Hey, what's up everyone? MACK Murdoc here with OPT, and in today's video, we're gonna be going over the top 15 summer targets. We are now leaving galaxy season and entering into Milky Way season, which brings us less bigger galaxies that are in our universe, but much bigger and brighter nebulas that are located in our own galaxy. Our own Milky Way has so many amazing ones to choose from, and you don't need a long-range telescope to be able to shoot them, which makes them a little bit easier than galaxy season, in my own personal opinion. And not only are we going to mention the best targets to image, but we're also going to mention what focal length to shoot them from, and I'll throw out a few personal recommendations on telescopes, filters, and accessories that might be helpful. These focal lengths are meant to have these targets fill the majority of the frame, so don't worry if you've got a little bit of a shorter or longer telescope, you can still get these targets and it will still be awesome. Now keep in mind, just like our winter and spring targets video, all focal lengths in this video are based off a micro four thirds size sensor, which is in cameras like the ASI 1600, so this will change depending on what camera and sensor you're shooting with. But first, before we get started, if you appreciate the love and effort that we put into these videos, please consider donating a click to the like button. It's free to do, and you can do it anywhere there's an internet connection. Here, I'll show you. All right, let's get into our top 15 summer targets. The first object on this list is actually one of the first objects I personally ever shot with a DSLR. It's the LAGOON Nebula. It's a bright emission nebula that lies in the constellation Sagittarius, 4,100 light years from home. The object is super bright and extremely large. In fact, you can see it with your naked eye. And if you've ever shot the Milky Way before, you've probably seen that purple-looking star and wondered what it was. This object is best shot at 400 to 600 millimeters to just get the lagoon, or you can zoom out at around 300 millimeters or less and get the TRIFID nebula, which is right next to it. This object can be shot in both broadband and narrowband, which makes it perfect for DSLRs as well. Our next object is the infamous Eagle Nebula, also known as M16. Home of the Hubble Space Telescope's most famous picture, the Pillars of Creation. The Eagle Nebula is an emission nebula that lives in the constellation Serpens 7,000 light years from Earth. It's best shot at around 600 to 1,000 millimeters in narrowband, but you can still definitely shoot it in broadband. If you want to get close in on the Pillars of Creation, you're looking at something around 2,500 millimeters. Now, if you're shooting the Eagle Nebula and pretty much most narrowband emission nebulas with a color camera, we would recommend using something like the Triad Ultra Filter or the Optolong L Extreme to really block out the light pollution and isolate the wavelengths that you really want most. With the Triad Ultra Filter, you can even image from the most light polluted cities, which is freaking awesome. I'm sure I'll make a video showing the power of the Triad Ultra Filter shooting from my Bortle Billion apartment in Hollywood, California. Our next target is one of the most beautiful and color ones in the night sky, in my own personal opinion. This area is called Rho Ophiuchi, located in the constellation Ophiuchus, only 460 light years from home. It's a beautiful cloud complex with dark nebulas around the bright stars of Antares, with thick dark gases and galactic dust. This object is huge and best shot around 100 millimeters in broadband. Check out this image taken by Dustin Gibson with a DSLR and Rogelio from Deep Sky Colors with a dedicated astrocam. Up at number four, we have the Omega Nebula, also known as the Swan Nebula and cataloged as M17. The Omega Nebula is around 5,500 light years away from Earth and located in the constellation Sagittarius. This object is best imaged around 800 to 1200 millimeters in narrowband, but you can definitely still shoot it in broadband. especially if you have an astro-modified camera, you can really pull out the bright hydrogen alpha data and see it really pop out of the Milky Way. Up at number 5, we have one of my favorite targets. In fact, it's the home to most of these targets. In fact, it's the home to us. It's our own Milky Way galaxy. Most people start astrophotography by shooting the Milky Way against a beautiful landscape. If you haven't shot the Milky Way galaxy before, make sure that you subscribe to this channel because we're going to be coming out with a tutorial on how to do that. But just as a basic overview, you can shoot the Milky Way untracked with just a DSLR, lens, and tripod. For that, we would recommend focal lengths around 14mm, 24mm, 35mm. Anywhere in there is personally where I like to stay. The wider your focal length, the more exposure time that you'll be able to shoot without seeing star trails. You can shoot it with higher focal lengths, but you're limiting yourself to the exposure time. But then we get into tracked images with a star tracker, like the iOptrum SkyGuider Pro or the SkyWatcher Star Adventure, which we've made a full tutorial on how to use and why you would want one that you can check out right here. This helps extend your exposure time by giving you less noise due to being able to drop down your ISO and give you so much more details. Here are a few images that I shot using the SkyWatcher Star Adventure. Also, don't forget that a sturdy tripod is so important so that you don't get any camera shake and it protects your image from the environment around you, like dragons. Our personal recommendation is the RADIAN carbon fiber tripod that we built for astrophotographers in mind. You can check out the full video on why this tripod is so great right over here. At number 6, we have the intricate TRIFID nebula, also known as M20. Located 5,200 light years away from home, right next to the LAGOON nebula in Sagittarius. The reason why I say intricate is because it's actually 3 different types of nebulae in one. This is the emission nebulae, this is the reflective nebulae, and this is the dark nebulae. Reflection nebulae are best shot in LRGB broadband, so I recommend that you shoot it in broadband. But you can also shoot it in narrowband and get some interesting variations. The TRIFID is best shot around 600 to 1000 millimeters. Now let me jump in here to let you know about light pollution filters. If you're shooting broadband LRGB targets, you want something that doesn't cut out too much of your spectrum, since LRGB is pretty much capturing most of it. So we would recommend something like the Optolong L Pro filter. On the other hand, if you're looking for a filter for those narrowband targets, we would recommend either using the L Enhance or the L Extreme or a personal favorite, the RADIAN Triad Ultra filter, which will allow you to shoot your favorite narrowband targets from the brightest of cities. All right, let's move on to number 7. We have the North American Nebula in the constellation of Cygnus. This emission nebula is an easy hop, skip, and a jump away at 1500 light years away from Earth. There's so much to unpack on this one. It's huge. You can capture the whole thing, filling the frame at about 150 millimeters. From our perspective, it's about 10 times bigger than the moon. It's best shot in narrowband, but can still be shot in broadband, and its two most notable features is the Cygnus Wall and Pelican Nebula. The Cygnus Wall is one of my top favorites. In fact, here's an image that I took with the Explorer Scientific 127 and the ASI 1600. Another great feature is the Pelican Nebula, located right here. Both targets are best shot around the 1000 millimeter mark. At number 8, we have the SATURN region, which is right next to the North American Nebula in the constellation of Cygnus. Another emission nebula, which is really rich in hydrogen alpha data. Best shot in narrowband around 150 millimeters, but broadband works as well. There is so much going on here, and if you've got a longer focal length telescope, you can literally pick any random spot and get some epic images over the hydrogen emission gases. Now, if you look right next to the SATURN region in the same Cygnus constellation, you'll find the 9th target, the Crescent Nebula. But let's be real with ourselves here, it doesn't look like a crescent, and therefore, let's call it the Brain Nebula. Cause well, it looks like a brain. The newly coined Brain Nebula is best shot in narrowband, specifically HA and O3 data. And you can get a pretty good detailed shot anywhere between 1000 and 2000 millimeters, which would almost fill up the frame. Use the hashtag Brain Nebula in your images so that we can check them out, and who knows, you might get featured. Our 10th target on this list is one of those that are super rich in HA and O3, and there's really not that much S2, to be honest with you. It's the Veil Nebula. The Veil Nebula is 2,400 light years from Earth and in the constellation of Cygnus. It's pretty much the remnants of a giant exploded supernova star. The Veil Nebula has three different parts. The Eastern Veil, or what I like to call the Joker Nebula, the Western Veil, also known as the Witch's Broom, and Pickering's Triangle. This is another very large target and can fill your whole frame at 275 millimeters, or you can capture each section at around 600 millimeters. 275 millimeters is perfect with the Radiant Raptor telescope, which we made a full video for that you can check out right here. Also, check out these Radiant t-shirts that say, for those who collect light in the dark. How cool is that? Also, if you haven't already, go hit the like button. Thanks. Our next summer object is the Elephant's Trunk Nebula, located in the Cepheus constellation 2,400 light years from home. Best shot in narrowband, and with enough data, it can be extremely vibrant and colorful. To get the full, big, bright nebula, you want to have a telescope around 200 to 300 millimeters. Something like the Radiant Raptor at 275 millimeters will fit the frame nicely. If you would like to get just the trunk itself, here's an image that I shot at 952 millimeters with the ASI 1600 of just hydrogen alpha data. Now let's switch things up a little for object number 12. We got Jupiter and Saturn, the two biggest gas giants in our solar system. They are some of the brightest dots in the sky and hard to miss. For both, it really helps to have a large focal length telescope around 2,000 millimeters and above to get some pretty decent details on these targets. You can definitely shoot them with less though. Check out our videos on the ASI 183 and the 174 for some good idea on planetary cameras by clicking the link right over here or down in the description. At number 13, we have the TULIP Nebula, reaching out at 5,800 light years from home in the Cygnus region. It's an emission nebula, which means it's best shot in narrowband, but the HA is definitely strong enough that you can pick up with broadband. It's best shot at 800 to 1500 millimeters. Some of the data is fairly faint, so make sure that you spend some good time getting some S2 and O3 wavelengths. At number 14, we have the Wizard Nebula. The Wizard Nebula is an emission nebula that lies 7,200 light years away from Earth in the constellation of Cepheus. The thing I personally love about this nebula is that you can really see the depth and layers of this nebula and see clearly what's in front and what's in back. The Wizard Nebula is a narrowband target, but others have been known to photograph this one in HARGB. I would recommend shooting this between 600 and 1200 millimeters of focal length. And finally, our last target on the list, the Dumbbell Nebula, also known as M27. This beautiful but small planetary nebula lies 1,300 light years away from Earth in the constellation Vulpeca. You can shoot this target around 1,000 to 3,000 millimeters. In fact, we made a really fun episode shooting the Dumbbell Nebula with a fully automated unistellar EV scope at only 450 millimeters that you can check out right over here. And that about covers it, guys. Was there one on the list that we didn't get to cover that you were really excited about? If so, let us know down below in the comments. And just as a friendly reminder, we've left some tools in the description below to help you determine what the best focal length is for your specific camera and telescope. If you guys like this video, don't forget to hit the thumbs up, subscribe, and hit the bell for notifications. My name is MACK Murdoc here with OPT, and we'll see you in the next video. Clear skies.